another Sunday, but his mercies are new, amen. And we have another opportunity, amen, to serve him and to get it right with him if we are not, amen. Again, I welcome you to our Sunday school live stream. I want to give honor to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I want to give honor to my pastor, Elder Bruce Elliott Bruce Sr. I want to give love to our Sunday school superintendent, missionary Jacqueline Williams, and also to our second assistant, well, our first assistant, excuse me, missionary, minister, Jerry Wilson. I'm all over the place this morning. He's in the building, amen, and his lovely wife. And to the mothers, the church mother, amen, that's here. I thank God for y'all being here. We have a wonderful lesson. Before we get into that, if you would like to give to this ministry, know that you can do so via Givelify at St. Stephen's Cogic, C-O-G-I-C, amen. And know that you're giving towards kingdom building, amen, for God, not just us, if you will, here at St. Stephen's, but in order to continue the kingdom spreading that we are required to do. And God will bless you for your generosity. There's a hymn in my spirit. I sing a little bit of it. It says, I shall not be moved. I shall not be moved, just like a tree that's planted by the water. I shall not be moved. Then it says, when my cross is heavy, I shall not be moved. When my cross is heavy, I shall not be moved, just like a tree that's planted by the water. I shall not be moved. Amen. Let us say a word of prayer. Oh, Father God, we just want to tell you thank you. Lord, we just want to thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus, for keeping us, God. Thank you for last night's rest, Lord. Thank you for your touch this morning. Thank you for waking us up, God. Thank you for the activities of our limbs, God. Thank you for a right mind, God. A mind that's founded and rooted in you, Lord. Thank you for the mind that want to come out to the house of worship, God. We could have stayed home, God. Not for any reason, but just because we wanted to stay home, God. And we thank you, Lord, for the mind to press our way, God. Oh, God, look on those that are listening, God, that are tuning in, God. Touch them where they are, God. Give them encouragement, God. Give them hope, God. Yeah. In the name of Jesus, God. Let them know that you are God, God of everything. You are always with us, God. And let us lean and trust in you, God. Oh, God, look on the services, God, that will be had today. Each church, God, that's represented, God, of the body of Christ, God. Be in the midst of their service, God. Get into the morning worship, God. Get into the invocation, God. Oh, God, and touch each speaker, God, that is speaking, delivering your word today, God. Be in the midst of their service, God. Give them what they need in the name of Jesus. Oh, God, look on our absent body of church, God. Oh, God, name by name, God. Sick and shut in, God. Touch them, God. Oh, God, look on our pastor, the elect lady, their family, God. All families represented here, God. Give us what we need, God, as we continue to do your work, your business, God. Strengthen us where we're weak, God. Oh, God, and give us a steadfast mind, God. In the name of Jesus, we pray, God. We ask all these things in your son's name, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Bless the Lord. We have a wonderful lesson today. Lesson two, because we have begun our summer quarter. Amen. And the topic is, why are you afraid? Last week we touched about what? On worrying. Amen. The lesson last week was, why do you worry? And today's lesson is talking about being afraid. Why are you afraid? We will proceed in developing the lesson in the following manner as it is printed in your books. We'll read the Bible basis, the Bible truth, the memory verse, and we'll touch on life need for today's lesson, Bible learning, Bible application, and students' responses. We only have 5 verses today, amen. We will read all of them in our like manner. So let us begin, amen. The Bible basis, Matthew 8, 23 through 27. And the Bible truth, Jesus allies the disciples' fears
there was a great calm. And that's Matthew 8:26. Like me for today's lesson, people often lose confidence amidst the storms of persecution, rejection, and poverty. Where can we find assurance when beset by the storms of life? Fearing they would not survive the windstorm, the disciples turned to Jesus to save them. Bible learning. Jesus' power over nature attests to his deity as the Son of God. Bible application. Christians look to Jesus in times of distress. Students' responses, believers will not fear. Amen. Beginning at verse 23. And when he was entered into a ship, his disciples followed him. And behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea, insomuch that the ship was covered with the waves, but he was asleep. 25, and his disciples came to him and awoke him, saying, Lord, save us, we perish. And he saith unto them, why are ye fearful, O ye of little faith? Then he arose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. The last verse, verse 27, but the men marveled, saying, what manner of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him? Amen. Bless the Lord for the reading of the word. I just want to talk a little bit about some background, because this particular lesson jumps right into a passage in regards to the disciples leaving with Jesus, amen, to get on a ship to cross the lake. So before this passage, in Matthew 8, Jesus is teaching about the cost of following him. You'll find that in Matthew 8:18-22. It's before this passage. And then it's also spoken about in Luke 9:51-62. It says the cost of following. I've read some commentary on that to just kind of summarize for you. The cost of following Jesus is not always easy or comfortable. Often means great cost, great sacrifice, with no earthly rewards or security. Amen. Discipleship is an investment. It requires total commitment and loyalty to Jesus that lasts for eternity and years, yields incredible rewards. It's not necessarily going to be payday here, amen, is what it's saying to us. Because we're storing up what? Treasure for above, amen. But the cost of discipleship is heavy. And so Jesus was teaching them about that, amen. He had a religious leader ask him, and I'm paraphrasing. Well, he didn't ask him, he said, I would follow him. And he responded to the religious leader that, you know, you want to follow me in so many words, but I have nowhere to lay my head. Meaning that he didn't have a home to go to, because he was discerning the religious leader's heart. He was just really talking, amen. Then another one came, and I'm paraphrasing. He asked, I'll follow you, but let me go first, bury my father. So Jesus told him, let the dead bury the dead. And that may sound harsh, but Jesus again was looking at his heart, amen, and seeing that he was really making an excuse, that I'm a follow you, but let me go take care of this. But Jesus was looking at his heart and saying, you got to follow me now. Amen. So we find ourselves now in this passage. Let us read the light on the word about chaotic seas. And it's printed in your books. In the Jewish mind, the sea represents chaos and mystery, and therefore offers many opportunities to showcase God's awesome power. God does what he wants with the raging sea because he is sovereign over all creation. It's Genesis 1 and 2. One of the greatest miracles recorded in the Bible is when Moses led Israel through the Red Sea on dry land. That's Exodus 14:15-31. Followed by Joshua as he led Israel through the raging Jordan River. And that's Joshua 3. Jesus displays his divine power over the chaotic waters when he calms the storm and when he walks on water. And also, I'm going to talk about, I got many books this morning. I want to read also in this book, it's in your book, The Peaceful Savior, underneath that. Picking up about the sea. The Sea of Galilee is a small freshwater lake about 600 feet below sea level. About 6 miles wide and 8 miles long. High mountains surround the lake on three sides. The Jordan River flows from the southern end of the Sea of Galilee down to the Dead Sea, about 1,300 feet below sea level. The mountains around the lake and the downward flow of the Jordan create a natural funnel. When winds blow from the mountains through this funnel, they produce sudden, violent storms, which is the type of storm that frightens the disciples. Some scholars suggest that the type of boisterous storm that develops should not have been able to form on the Sea of Galilee. The disciples' fear is magnified to the point that they believe death is inevitable.
Amen.
And in another book, I want to give you the essential theme of this lesson today as we study it. The essential theme is this in this passage is about faith. Jesus took authority over the situation at hand. He rebuked them first before he commanded the storm to die down. Luke 8:22-40 indicates that when the disciples initially went on the boat, the sea was calm. Christ's word to us is, we must prepare for the storm and for great peril in that storm. Remember, I read to you that the cost of discipleship is heavy.
Amen.
All right. There is no relief for souls under a sea of guilt and fear of wrath. The disciples went to Jesus. When they awakened Jesus, he asked the question, why are you afraid? Jesus had prepared them for the storm-tossed sea. Catch that. He had prepared them for the storm-tossed sea. All they had to do was use the authority that God had given them. All right. Let us dive into these verses. Amen. Verse 23 and 24, it says, and when he was entered into the ship, Jesus, his disciples followed him. 24 picks it up and says, and behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea, insomuch that the ship was covered with the waves, but he was asleep. Amen. And I underline that. The small fishing boat, we're reading underneath that verse, set sail for the opposite shore with Jesus and his disciples. The eastern shore where they are headed is much less populated, so Jesus and his disciples will be able to rest and refresh themselves. As the boat makes its way across the lake, Jesus takes a nap and drops off into a deep, peaceful slumber. Amen. Under the light of the word in your books is titled rest. I'm going to skip all the way to the end because I want to pick up on that rest. Doing ministry is God's will. We know that. But at times, we may push ourselves past the point of effectiveness because we become exhausted. Jesus wants us to work for him, and he also wants us to rest. Amen. Now, we see, though, the comparison. In the midst of the storm, it said that Jesus, what? Was asleep. He had peaceful slumber. Amen. So the rest was a little bit more than just physical. Amen. It was spiritual rest. Amen. That he could have peace in the midst of the storm. Oh, I'm going somewhere today. Amen. I'm a little slow this morning, but I'm going somewhere in this lesson. Amen. All right. Let us continue to move through. Verse 25. And his disciples came to him and awoke him, saying, Lord, save us, we perish. So reading underneath that, most of the disciples grew up around the Sea of Galilee, and several of them are seasoned fishers. They are familiar with the sudden storms common to the lake, but they had never seen anything like this. After doing all they can to keep the boat afloat, the frightened disciples call Jesus, waking him from sleep. One cries, Master, Master, we perish. That's found in Luke 8:24. Because this is bringing out the fact of the synoptic gospels that I mentioned last week. That you have three books of the gospels that basically told about the same events, amen, just written by different authors. So they were like in togetherness in regards to the events. So in Luke 8:24, it says, one cries out, Master, Master, we perish. Another shouts in Mark 4:38, Master, carest thou not that we perish? Amen. And then in today's lesson, Matthew 8:25 says, the disciples are never truly in a hopeless situation. Jesus expects the disciples to have faith in what? His word. And we can glean right there. No matter what we go through, we are never in a hopeless situation. Believers of Christ. Why? Because he is our hope. He is a sovereign God. He has won the victory for us. So nothing should to scare us. Nothing should have us trembling. Nothing should have us fearful that we lose what? Hope. All right. Verse 27, and I tell you, the lesson is quick today. Amen. But the men marveled, saying, "What manner of man is this that even the winds and the sea obey him?" Not only did he ask them, "Why are ye afraid?" Right? He asked them because he wanted to teach them. He rebuked them in a way. Amen. Why are you afraid? Oh, ye of what? Little faith. And then he turned to the storm because he has power, all power in his hand, and he rebuked the storm. And he calmed the storm. And so then in 27, they marveled. They couldn't even believe it. But he had healed in front of them. But I think that they were just thinking that, hey, he can heal, but he doesn't have control over the nation.
That's good.
And we can glean that now with this climate that we're in. He's a healer.
Yes,
amen.
He is.
Not just of our physical body, but of diseases and peril that come against us. Amen. So we shouldn't fear. Yes, we should do, you know, we should seek him, amen, and what we should do, amen, in regards to this time. But our ultimate hope and trust is in who? Him. He is able to heal. He is able to deliver, amen, because he is in control of all things, amen. So I want to read the light of the word. It's printed in your books, and we're actually coming to an end. It's titled, "Why Are You Afraid?" Amen. And it says, the three explanations recorded by the three writers describe three possible responses to troubles that afflict us. We're talking about the Synoptic Gospels in regards to what they wrote on this event that we talked about today. Some of us may think that the Lord is unaware of the depth of our torment. Others realize that God knows all, but because he is not acting the way we think he should, we begin to wonder if he even cares. And then finally, some simply cry out in desperation, "Lord, if you don't save me, I'll perish." This takes nothing away from those with great faith, having complete trust in the Lord, which moves all worry and doubt. The power of God always, not sometimes, always backs the promises of God. Amen. Even when we cannot see God's power at work in our lives, we must take comfort that he will save, deliver, and work out all situations for our good. And that's found in Romans 8 and 23. So I'm just going to summarize a little bit all of what we've gotten today, this morning, amen, with a scripture and a song, amen. The lyrics of a song. The scripture that I thought about when I was studying this lesson was from David, Psalm 61, 1 through 2. I'm reading it in the God's Word translation. It says, "Listen to my cry for help, O God." That's what they needed. They cried out for help, amen. They cried out to be saved, amen. And it says, "Pay attention to my prayer. Hear me, O Lord." Yeah. Verse 2 picks it up. It says, "From the ends of the earth, I call to you when I begin to lose heart." That's what we're supposed to do, amen. Call to him when we lose heart. Call to him when our faith is shaken, amen. "Lead me to the rock that is high above me." Amen. So the songwriter
Lord.
Not you, Lord.
Yes.
Jesus. Not some random person. And I'm not being disrespectful. But Jesus, lead me to the rock that's higher than I.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
In teaching us that we have to have faith and we have to build our faith. How are we going to do that? By reading his word. Amen. Whatever the world is saying to you that is against you, amen. Read his words so he can tell you who you really are. Amen. So he can tell you that there's hope. So that he can tell you that, I know the thoughts that I have about you. Thoughts for you to what? Prosper. Thoughts for you to be good. Jesus, we pray. Amen.